فاسألوا أهل الذكر إن كنتم لا تعلمون.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. Dear viewers, brothers and sisters in Islam, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. I'm your host, Kareem Abu Zaid, and this is another edition of Let's Talk About It. I welcome you, dear viewers, brothers and sisters in Islam. I welcome your questions, comments, suggestions, your contribution to the show. بإذن الله تعالى, we selected a theme for the month of December regarding Prophet Isa عليه الصلاة والسلام. Is he divine? And we've been talking about this. The way our show is structured, that we compile as many questions as possible from your phone calls first. And the phone number is shown on the screen, 1-800-587-9075. And also Facebook page, www.facebook.com/islamqa.tv. Please, dear viewers, if you can go and like that page. This is where actually we post videos that you have missed, or video that you have watched live. The recorded version of them, of these videos, will be posted on YouTube, inshallah, and the link will be shared on that Facebook page as well. We also have Islam QA, Kareem at IslamQA.tv, or Kareem at Huda.tv. Kareem, my first name, at Huda.tv. These are email addresses that you can definitely use to call us and get in touch with us and ask your questions. Again, dear viewers, 1-800-587-9075. Please give us a call. It's time to take your questions as we speak, بإذن الله تعالى. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. This is Om Ikhlas. I'm calling from California. I'd like to know the benefits of black seed and how to take it and how much to take it daily.
Okay. Jazakallahu khairan, Om Ikhlas. I will try to answer that question, but to give you specifics, inshallah, I promise to prepare it. And next Monday, if you can watch the show, I will give you a detailed answer, inshallah. Because right now I don't recall a lot of information on the subject, but I will definitely prepare something on Monday, show and share with you, بإذن الله تعالى.
Okay.
If you don't mind, if you want, I can send you some information. If you send me an email, Kareem at Huda.tv, Ikhlas, I can send you right away something, بإذن الله تعالى. But jazakallahu khairan for calling. We appreciate your call. Barakallahu fiki.
Yeah.
Now, salamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. So, dear viewers, 1-800-587-9075. Our first caller, sister Ikhlas, she is asking regarding black seed, al-habba sauda, and the fact that it is a cure in our religion. And it's part of the prophetic medication which Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us to use for cure, inshallah. Inshallah, I will try my best to compile something and share it with the viewers in general and with Sister Ikhlas as well. Again, 1-800-587-9075. 1-800-587-9075. 9075. Please give us a call. It is time to compile as many questions as possible. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. This is Brother Mustafa from Denver.
Brother Mustafa from Denver, how are you doing, Brother Mustafa?
Good, how are you?
Alhamdulillah, alhamdulillah. Good to hear from you. And you have a question for us tonight?
Yes, so just, هل يجوز استعمال الرقية الشرعية from YouTube?
جزاك الله خيرا, Brother Mustafa. May Allah reward you. I will answer you. Will you be watching our show, inshallah?
Yes.
Okay, I will answer you, Brother Mustafa. May Allah reward you.
جزاك الله
خيرا. So our brother Mustafa from Denver, Colorado is asking whether it is permissible or not to just listen to the verses and the supplications which are taken out of the Quran and the Sunnah as the ruqya al-shar'iyya, but not from the life Raqi, a person who does the incantation, rather from the radio or the TV, we will do that as well. Inshallah, we'll answer you bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, Brother Mustafa. Jazakallahu khaira. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. This is Misha again. I'm from Canada. How are you?
Jazakallahu khaira. Alhamdulillah, Sister Misha from Canada. Barakallahu fiki. May Allah reward you for asking. You have a question for us tonight.
I have again two more questions.
Okay.
I just like to know, I have a baby who's 14 months, and when I pray, he comes in front of the, when I do the sujood on the mat, and is that going to affect my prayer by anyhow? Because he is not controllable, because he moves a lot, and in anywhere I put, he will get down and come where I pray.
Is that your child, right? Is he around That's you while you're praying? And inshallah, we'll answer you bi-idhnillah ta'ala. Jazakallahu khairan. May Allah preserve and guard him, inshallah. Our sister Misha from Canada, her first question is regarding having a child. An infant basically, who would have to actually watch him while she's praying, and he does a lot of movements, and that sometimes distract her, concentration.
That's basically all the time he does that.
Okay.
It's only the Isha prayer, okay. Only the Fajr prayer I could do peacefully, because that's the only time he sleeps.
Okay.
The other time, even if I put him in the sofa or bed, he can come down from anywhere. And
I got you.
Yes.
Inshallah, we'll answer.
The other
that.
Question I have, it's a very sensitive subject that I would like to really know. I have some family members who are recently, they were kind of religious. Well, they used to pray like 5 times, and then. Ever since they came in Canada, they got some kind of scholar following up, and I don't know who are they actually. I don't even know their name. They actually convinced them, telling them that the prayers is not actually necessary to do it, because Allah knows your heart. If you're a good heart, it's good enough to go to Jannah.
Okay, that's a million-dollar question, and I will answer you, inshallah.
It's affecting my family now, because as you said, before getting married, you should see who you person getting married. The person was fine, was praying 5 times a day, and all of a sudden they change, and what is changing my life now? So, I don't know who to ask for.
Is that a relative of yours? Let me ask you, a relative of yours?
It's my husband.
Oh, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. May Allah make it easy on you, ya ukhti, wallahi. Wallahi, this is a big...
And he changed so much that he doesn't even like if I do hijab and everything, and he actually changed a lot. I don't know what to say.
Yeah, may Allah make it easy on you. That's your test. That's your test. That's your test. I will share some thoughts with you, Sister Misha. May Allah make it easy on you, Akhti. Barakallah feek.
Just let me know, how I can help to change the situation and bring it back like before, you know?
Right. I will say something, inshallah. That's very, you know, when I see somebody, you know, in my opinion, this is one of the hardest tests that a person goes through. When you find your loved one, whether a husband, daughter, son, turning away from the religion and going, taking another way. And what can you do to bring them back? I will try, Sister Misha, to say something. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. This voice.
This is Ishaq from Denver, Sheikh.
MashaAllah, Ishaq, how are you doing? His voice sounds so familiar.
Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. Sheikh, how are you?
Oh, MashaAllah, it's so nice to hear your voice tonight.
Alhamdulillah, Sheikh. Wallahi, we miss you in Denver.
Jazakallah.
You have to tell us when are you going to be coming, inshallah.
Bi-ibnillah, you know, I'm coming on I'm calling it Yawmul Furqan, the day of the criterion, the 19th of December. And I know a lot of brothers and sisters are watching us from Denver. This day is so important for our community in Denver. Because this is the day which, inshallah, will mark that we're finally executing and giving attention to one of the neglected segments of our community, which is the youth, Ishaq. Yes. And you know, you cannot imagine. I'm dreaming of getting that place for the ummah there. And I'm making a lot of dua, and I know in the depth of my heart that inshallah Allah will make it happen. And I know, Ishaq, you're also.
Jazakumullah khair, Sheikh.
You're also.
I like the annotation, Yawmul Furqan. I love that. I am, Sheikh, as you know, I'm one of the organizers of the fundraiser, inshallah. And I wanted to use, I don't have any question in specific. But I wanted to use this opportunity to invite your listeners in general and the people from Denver, Aurora, and Colorado in particular to come join us for this great, great, great event. Whether you want to donate or not, just come in, inshallah, join. We have, alhamdulillah, prepared a very good dinner for you. So we are going to be getting together. We are going to be having dinner. Bring your family, children. We have babysitting available, inshallah. And you will get to see the facilities. You will touch them, feel them, see them, inshallah. And keep us in your du'as. I wanted to use this opportunity to invite all of your listeners, whether they watch it through the net or they come in person. Please come, join us, have dinner with us, and be a part of this very memorable occasion, inshallah.
You heard Brother Ishaq, dear brothers and sisters in Islam. I echo his invitation. Please, especially the brothers in Denver and Colorado. This is the future of the ummah. This is the youth. This is the sisters. Inshallah, Brother Ishaq, and I say Jazakallahu khairan for that invitation. And I hope it has reached everybody. بإذن الله تعالى بارك الله فيك brother إسحاق and may Allah سبحانه وتعالى reward you.
إياكم جد. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله
وبركاته. وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. ما شاء الله brother إسحاق said it all from Denver. He's inviting brothers like brother أيمن yesterday. ما شاء الله. He called in and he invited everybody. طيب جزاك الله خيرا. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته. My name is Ahmed. I'm calling from Toronto, Canada.
From Canada, Brother Ahmed, how are you doing?
I'm doing good, alhamdulillah. How are you, Sheikh?
Alhamdulillah. And your question tonight?
Yes. Is there any particular dua we should say when it's raining or snowing?
Certain dua when it is snowing or raining. Jazakallahu khair. We'll answer you, Brother Ahmed. Barakallahu feek.
Oh, yeah.
Barakallahu feek. Ahsanallahu ilaykum. Masha'Allah, the phone line is busy tonight. I also want to remind myself that before I answer Ikhlas, Mustafa from Denver, Ikhlas from California, Mustafa from Denver, and Sister Misha from Canada, and Brother Ishaq had no question, so I was relieved there. And Brother Ahmed from Canada, we have Sister Abdurrahman from last night, from Maryland. She left us with a big chunk of questions, three big questions, so I hope time will allow us. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum
wa rahmatullah. Name, state, and...
My name is Ali, and I'm from Lubbock, Texas.
Yes, Brother Ali, and your question tonight?
My question is, I want to ask you, what is the regarding if he is in a state, a person can't get married?
Okay, Brother Ali, can you turn down the TV or whatever you're watching, because there is a split of seconds there between your actual conversation and what you hear, and that delays you. So I can get the question, please. Jazakallah khair. Just turn it down while you're asking, and then you can go back to listen to it, inshallah. Go ahead.
Oh, okay.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay, can you hear me better?
Yes, absolutely now. Go ahead, please.
Okay, if a person can get married, and if he masturbates, protect himself from committing sin.
Okay, so the ruling on masturbation, that's what you're asking.
Yeah.
Jazakallahu khaira, barakallahu feek. We'll answer you, Brother Ali, barakallahu feek. Brother Ali from Texas, jazakallahu khaira. Okay, so we have Brother Ali from Texas with his question here. Again, I want to remind myself, and please, my helpers here in the studio, please remind me to not to forget Sister Abdurrahman from last night. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
Naam, name, state, and question.
Wa alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. My name is Ahmed. I'm from Toronto, Canada.
Brother Ahmed from Toronto, Canada. And your question tonight, Brother Ahmed.
My question is, since I heard that there is a little alcohol in Pepsi and Coca-Cola, so is it permissible to drink it?
Are you certain about that?
I heard about the mixing of sugars and...
But are you certain? Are you certain about this? Because I heard that, and nothing really was authenticated. Dear viewers, if you're familiar with what Brother Ali is saying, that Coca-Cola has alcohol in it. I heard that rumor. Then I asked the individual to authenticate this, but he wasn't able to. So before we even explore it, listen, if there is any substance out there which contains any amount of liquor or intoxicating agent, certainly it's haram, even if it does not intoxicate. That's the ruling in general. But we call this unrestricted ruling. But now to apply this to a certain nutrition, we have to have, or beverage, we have to have legitimate, information. So Brother Ali, if you can research this and get us some good, legitimate information on the subject, we would really appreciate it. So at least on that live show, we can actually warn people. But I can do this if I'm uncertain that this is not true. Go ahead, Brother Ali. Brother Ahmed, go ahead.
Yes. I also have a question. It's that when the Isha prayer can be recorded in the movie.
Okay, the line is disconnecting, Brother Ahmed, so can you make this a little bit clear? Can you repeat that statement again, please?
Yeah, I was saying, when does Isha prayer end?
Okay.
Yeah, what's the time which ends, like, approximate time?
for Isha time to, that's another question, right?
Yes.
Okay, you're asking when does Isha comes?
Yes.
Okay, where do you live?
I live in Toronto.
You don't have like a local masjid where you can find out the time for Isha?
Yes.
You do?
Yeah, I do.
So what is the nature of your question? You're trying to figure out, Isha normally comes 1 hour and 20 minutes around the time, from the time of Maghrib, an hour and 25, 30 minutes more or less. But again, at that age and time, Brother Ahmed, we do have all these means, you know, whether Islam Finder, Islamic Finder, even we have these calendars that already printed with the times for the whole year. So even if you go on Google, you know, Isha time in Toronto, Canada, you will get the time, exact time. Jazakallahu khairan, Brother Ahmed. Barakallahu feek.
Alhamdulillah.
All right. Barakallahu feek. Call us again, Brother Ahmed. May Allah reward you, inshallah. So dear viewers, let me try now to get into, first of all, I have to say something about our theme, so we're honoring the theme here. Brothers and sisters in Islam, I'll still accept your phone calls. I was told that three more minutes are left before 10 o'clock. So if you have a question, please call us. Okay, I do have a caller right here. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Alaikum salam wa rahmatullah. This is Misha. I think I got disconnected with you, so I was calling back.
Oh, okay, Sister Misha, go ahead.
Yeah, so the actual question, the second one that I was asking, that how to deal, because every time I ask him to pray, it actually turns to a kind of argument or fight. So basically what I do right now, I don't even ask.
Well, let me ask you, why do you need to ask someone to pray? You do not need the permission, do you?
No, not for me. I'm for him. Like.
Oh, I see.
Invite him to pray.
Okay, I got you. Will you be watching the show?
I'm actually watching the live right now. So
okay, so I will answer you, inshallah. I'll answer your question, inshallah, in the order I received it, bidnillahi ta'ala.
Thank you,
Barakallahu feek. Assalamu alaikum wa barakatuh. Okay, dear viewers, I guess now we can explore, and I will still accept your phone calls if it comes while I'm talking. Divinity, Isa alayhi salatu wassalam, the son of Allah. Something so fascinating that you should pay attention to. And this is the beauty of reflecting upon the Quran. The story of the birth of Prophet Isa alayhi salam was mentioned in two places in the Quran. The first place is in Surah Ala Imran. Surah Ala Imran, beginning وَإِذْ قَالَتِ الْمَلَائِكَةُ يَا مَرْيَمُ إن الله اصطفاك وطهرك واصطفاك على نساء العالمين. Remember when the angels called upon Maryam عليها السلام. Maryam is the mother of Isa عليه الصلاة والسلام. Allah has chosen you, selected you for something that no other woman will ever be chosen to do, which is basically having a child without a father. So, you see, I'm trying to throw something at you quickly here. So this is the beginning. And then the verses carried on. Ya Maryam uqnuti li rabbiki wasjudi warka'i ma'a raki'in. Oh Maryam, this is going to be a big test. And when you normally go through a hard test, your iman, faith has to be elevated. You have to have strong iman. And the way to increase your iman, the best thing that you can do is salah, uqnuti, stand in salah at night, long hours, wasjudi, warka'i ma'a raka'in. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives her the glad tiding of Isa alayhi salatu wassalam. So this is the first place. The second place in Surah Maryam, in chapter Maryam. Again, it started with وَذْكُرْ فِي الْكِتَابِ مَرْيَمَ إِذِ انْتَبَذَتْ مِنْ أَهْلِهَا مَكَانًا شَرْقِيًّا. Mention in the book Maryam when she withdrew from her people and she seeked a refuge in the eastern side of the masjid. فَاتَّخَذَتْ مِنْ دُونِهِمْ حِجَابًا. Aho. So the story started there. Tonight I'm addressing the issue of Isa alayhi salam is the son of Allah. Of course, Christians, they say that Jesus is the son of God, and Christmas is about the celebration of the birth of the son of Allah. That's what they do. Of course, I say subhanallah. As a Muslim, I say subhanallah. Ta'ala Allah. Allah is above that. Glorified and exalted is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To be attributed to such a thing. قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدْ لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ وَلَمْ يَكُلْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدْ. But the point that I'm trying to make tonight in 5 minutes time, so I answer the questions, is in those two places in the Quran, first Surah Al-Imran, second Surah Maryam, before the story of the birth of Isa was mentioned, subhanallah, the story of the birth of Yahya was mentioned. I'll take that phone call and I'll come back to this. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Naam, name, state and question please.
I'm Isa.
Your name is who?
Isa.
Misha.
Yeah.
Calling from where?
Colorado.
Colorado. And what can we do for you tonight?
My name is Isa.
Oh, your name is Isa.
Yeah.
Allahu Akbar. Beautiful name. We're talking about Prophet Isa tonight. MashaAllah, Isa. What can we do for you tonight, Isa?
I have a question.
Sure. Go ahead, Brother Isa.
How did Adam went out of Jannah? Yeah.
Okay, Brother Isa.
Sure.
Will you be watching?
Yes.
You will?
Inshallah.
Inshallah. Okay. That's a big question, so.
How Adam came down from Jannah to earth.
Okay, I will do that. The reason why, right? You're asking the reason why, not how he made it down, right? The reason why, right?
Yeah.
You never know what imagination of. How old are you, Isa?
8.
8 years old, mashallah, Isa. Jazakallah khairan, barakallah fi. Inshallah, we'll answer you, Brother Isa.
Barakallah.
Wa iyyakum, barakallah fi, mashallah. So, the point I was trying to make right before the phone call of Brother Isa, that right before the mentioning of the story of the birth of Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, because he was born without a father, so Christians, they say that Allah he's the son of Allah. Of course, they say that. But now, why? What is the wisdom that the story of Zakaria and the birth of Yahya was mentioned before it? Because if you actually inspect the birth of Yahya, John the Baptist, that's the biblical term or the biblical name, you find it actually more miraculous. Because imagine how Zakaria alayhi salatu wasalam described himself. ذكر رحمة ربك عبده زكريا إذ نادى ربه نداء خفيا قال رب إني وهن العظم مني واشتعل الرأس شيبا. Oh Allah, my bones are weakened. You know that bones are the last thing that can stand in a person's body. My bones are weak. And my hair is graying, all of it. Some of the accounts in the books of tafsir that he was 99 years old. So fraternity, or I think that's the word, is no longer there. Add to this, وَامْرَأَتِي عَاقِرٌ, and my wife has been barren all along. He called upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, O Allah, bestow upon me a son. I want a son, O Allah, not to inherit my wealth. No, this son is to inherit the knowledge. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. My name is Ahmed, I'm from Toronto, Canada.
Brother Ahmed from Toronto, Canada. And your question tonight?
Yeah, my question is, in schools, there is an odd subject where they tell us to draw pictures of humans. So is that not in Islam?
So you're drawing them, or what do you do with the pictures?
Like,
what do you do with the pictures? I mean, what is this? You're drawing.
Because I heard in the Day of Judgment, you will be asked to put life in it.
Okay. Are you required to do this? This is a mandatory subject that you have to take, and without it, you will not graduate. Yes?
No, we can skip it though.
You can skip it. Thank you very much. Jazakallahu khairan. Barakallahu fi. Then skip it, brother. Jazakallahu khairan. I'll answer you, inshallah. But then skip it. That's the big answer. The quick answer, inshallah. So I want to get to my point here. The wife is barren. He's 99 years old. And yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala still giving him a child. Brothers and sisters in Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually taught us how to respond to this argument in the Quran. You're saying that Isa alayhi salam is the son of Allah because he did not have a father. What about Adam? Inna mathala Isa inda Allah. Inna mathala Isa inda Allah kamathali Adam. خلقه من تراب ثم قال له كن فيكون. Indeed, the likeness of Prophet Isa عليه السلام in the sight of Allah is like Adam. Adam did not have a father nor a mother. Then if this is the criteria upon which you will judge whether this person is the son or not, the one who really deserves to be labeled or called the son of Allah would be Adam, ideally. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to show the children of Israel his might and power and miracle. You see, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam without a father, without a mother. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Eve, Hawa, from a father without a mother. Hawa was created from Adam, from the rib of Adam. Sahih. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Isa from a mother without a father. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created me and you from a father and a mother. You see that variety? I think my point is made, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Walaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. How are you doing, Shaykh?
Alhamdulillah. How are you doing? Name, state, and question, please.
My name is Mansoor. I'm calling from Everett, Washington State. And my question is two questions, real quick. Nothing too, complicated.
Okay.
My question is, right now, I've been working at a serving restaurant, and they serve pork in here, and they serve, you know, these haram burgers, you know, the beef burgers. And I was wondering if I'm allowed to work here still, because I'm just, you know, I've started practicing, you know, alhamdulillah, recently. My religion, I've been, you know, Muslim my whole life, but I've taken it seriously recently, and I was wondering if it's okay for me to work here, if it's permissible.
Okay.
And my second.
What do you do? What do you do, Mansoor, in the restaurant?
I serve the food. I take the people's orders, and I wash the dishes sometimes.
I
don't like. And sometimes, yeah, I would have to take the pork and the food out. You know, like it's wrapped in the foil or whatever, but I don't have to ever directly touch it or anything.
Okay. Okay. I got you. I got you. Jazakallah khairan. Barakallah.
Okay.
You have another question, Brother Mansoor?
Yes, yes, Sheikh. My second question is, as right now, I've been growing up with the Hanafi Mazhab, and that's what I've been following, and I've noticed recently that some of the hadiths that Imam Abu Hanifa used for things such as, you know, where to put the hands during the prayer, and we don't do the Rafa Yadin, you know, when we get up from ruku and all that, and I've read Sahih Bukhari and Sahih Muslim, and I've seen that the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to do that, and the hadith of those are sahih, and the hadith in the Hanafi Mazhab I've seen are zaif. So I wanted to see what do I follow? Do I just stick with the Hanafi Mazhab, or do I follow the sahih hadith?
Got you. Jazakallahu khairan, Brother Mansoor. Barakallahu feek. I'll answer you inshallah bi'idhnillah.
Okay, thank you, Sheikh. I appreciate it.
Ahsan Allahu ilayk. Keep watching, inshallah. We'll answer all these questions, even if we have to extend the time tonight, inshallah, to maybe 10 minutes or so. I don't want to deprive anybody. So now, let's go to Abdul Rahman. She called us yesterday and she said, regarding student loans, imam, without naming anybody here, said that there is ijma' regarding the permissibility, that it is permissible to take student loans. Let me take that question. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Naam. Name, state and question, please.
This is Umm Sumayya. I'm calling from state of Maryland.
So, Sister Sumayya from Maryland, and your question tonight.
I was calling to ask, can you give me an advice on how to be a better Muslim?
In what area? Are you wearing your hijab, Sumayya?
Yes.
Are you praying five times a day?
Yes.
How old are you?
I'm 9.
Okay, mashallah, this is so good. Are you listening to your daddy and mommy?
Yes.
All right. Are you listening to your teacher?
Yes.
Mashallah, may Allah bless you. You're doing wonderful. Just keep doing what you're doing. Are you memorizing the Quran?
Okay. Yes.
You are memorizing the Quran?
Yes.
Allahu Akbar. Just keep doing what you're doing. This is wonderful.
Okay.
Jazakallahu khairan, Sumayya. I answered her. Barakallahu feek. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum wa salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Naam. Name, state and question, please.
My name is Saad Abbasi.
Saad Abbasi?
Yes.
Okay.
I'm from Maryland.
Okay, Brother Saad.
And I had a question about with regards to moon sighting in the start of Ramadan.
Okay, what is the question, Brother Saad?
Well, the local masjid that I go to, most of it follows, goes according to the calendar that Isna creates, and then there's a small group that goes by the local moon sighting. So when we're starting Muslim Ramadan, which should I go with? So like, what group should I follow?
Okay, Jazakallah khairan. That's $1 million question, I'll tell you, Saad. Inshallah, we'll answer you with Allah Ta'ala. Jazakallah khairan.
Oh, yeah.
Barakallah feek. MashaAllah. We're busy tonight. So, the sister is saying that there is ijma' regarding it's permissible to take student loans. Let me ask you, the word ijma' is really misused here. When we say ijma', we're referring to the consensus of the first three praised generations. All right? I think what the sister is referring to, the fact he say that the majority of the scholars few jurists, the majority of the jurists, we don't call this ijma'. We don't call this ijma'. The ijma' must conform with the sharia, with the Quran and the sunnah. Dear sister, dear brother, let's define usury. Let's define usury. What is usury? That somebody gives you a sum of money and he receives that money back with an increase. Isn't that what student loans are all about? That's what the definition of usury is, of riba is. Now, is it haram or halal? It's haram, absolutely. Now, if you get a few jurists saying that you can do it, they are going against the evidence, they are going against the Quran and Sunnah, and we shouldn't be calling this ijma'. The second question, our sister Umm Abdul Rahman, yes, I agree. She said that in a lot of our Islamic centers, of course she was addressing her own community center, the teaching of aqidah, of the belief system, is neglected. And I will tell you, dear brothers and sisters in Islam, and I know a lot of people watching me right now are students of knowledge like myself. If you want to mobilize your community and if you want to make a difference, you should begin with the aqidah, with the belief system. Let the people know what they believe in. And this is the methodology of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spent 13 years in Mecca. All what he focused on is to teach his companions the belief system, what we know by the aqidah or al-iman or the tawheed. Hence, I advise the brothers and the sisters who are in charge of communities, masajid, community centers, to promote the teaching of aqidah in their centers in order to, it will unite Muslims, it will get Muslims together. A lot of Muslims will get together because of it. Now, if the imam, because I, quite frankly, the subject of aqidah is very, you really need somebody who has it. You know, it's not every person can find it an easy subject to talk about. But if the imam is not of that type, there is no harm to invite an outsider, somebody who can, a guest speaker, who can come and talk about aqidah in your masjid. Now, dear sister, you were asking, what should I do? You should go in person and advise the imam to do so. Whether he can teach you aqidah in the masjid, maybe he can study and come and teach, or whether he can invite somebody to come and teach from outside. But now you should not advise him in public, dear sister. You should not go in front of everybody and tell him you have to do that. This could be misunderstood. We have to give respect to our imams, regardless, inshallah. The sister is asking regarding Salafiyya. Salafi is not a sect, just to get to the point. Salafiyya is a methodology to understand the Quran and the Sunnah. Salafiyya, the word Salaf, means predecessors, people who lived before you. Now, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us to learn and adopt the methodology of the first three brave generations. So we call this Salaf. So once you turn this into a sect, into a circle, is no longer valid. Is no longer valid. Now, the question here that I think the sister was asking, should I go out there and say, okay, I'm a Salafi? I'll give you a good scenario here. If I go into a masjid and I know that 100% or 90% of the people who visit this masjid or observe rituals in this masjid are misinformed regarding the term Salafi, Salafiyya, Salaf. They misinformed because that term has been abused by people. And now if I step in there and I'm supposed to be delivering a lecture, and if I step into this masjid and I stand up and I say, okay, everybody, I'm a Salafi, 75% of the people will be leaving. What benefit did I do? Huh? What did I do here? I turned people away. No, I'd rather stay. I'm going to teach the methodology. I'm going to teach it. I'm going to let them know what's it about without having to go through this. So it is sometimes not recommended at all to single out yourself in this manner. Add to this, if you're doing it in a fashion to create sectarianism, that's the word, right? Like you're trying to create a sect. You're trying to make a group within the ummah. This is something that you should not do. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in so many of his battles, he would actually place al-Ansar together and would give them the banner called al-Ansar. He would actually place al-Muhajirin together and he would give them a banner called the banner of al-Muhajirin. Imagine this. So to work for Allah, it's okay. You see? But at one time, al-Muhajirin and al-Ansar stood against one another and they said, we are al-Ansar, you are al-Muhajirin. He said, this is Jahiliyyah. Why? Because you're using that term in a negative way, in a destructive way. Add to this, I think it's important to realize that sometimes if you say you're a Salafi, you're really praising yourself. I mean, I'm striving. I'm not saying that I'm 100% on that on the way of the Salaf. I'm striving. You know, I'm trying to make it. I'm trying to be like Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman and Ali and Talha and Zubayr and Sa'd and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with them and the rest of the three brave generations, even al-Tabi'in, Sa'id ibn al-Musayyab, al-Hasan al-Basri, Ata, Mujahid, Sa'id ibn Jubayr. I'm trying, Abu al-Aliya, I'm trying, Muhammad ibn Ka'b al-Qurdi, I'm trying. So if I say I'm a Salafi, then I'm confirming that I'm identical to them. I already reached their status. Huh? So sometimes actually it's not, فَلَا تُزَكُّوا أَنفُسَكُمْ, do not praise yourselves, هُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِمَنِ اتَّقَى. Sister Umm Ikhlas, I promised, inshallah, I will. It's certainly been established in authentic ahadith that al-habba al-sawda, the black seed, is a cure for, listen to this, aging, it fortifies your immune system, that's as far as I recall, that makes your immunity against diseases high, so you actually take it as a protective, protective medicine, not a curing medicine, but a protective medicine against a lot of things. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Ahlan wa sahlan shaykhin, how are you?
Alhamdulillah, how are you doing? Name, state and question, please.
Alhamdulillah. Thank you very much for the advice and we welcome back to Denver, Colorado.
Jazakallahu khairan. Ahlan
wa sahlan, welcome.
Jazakallahu khairan. Barakallahu fiki, sister. What are you calling from Denver?
I'm calling Denver, Colorado. Zahra Mu'allim.
Sister Zahra, we're going to see you on the 19th, inshallah, right?
We miss you so much.
Inshallah, we're going to see you on the 19th, right, of December?
Inshallah.
Inshallah, Sister Zahra. Jazakallah khair. You have a question?
Alhamdulillah. Welcome very much.
Okay. Assalamu alaikum. Sa'at wa barakatuh. Inshallah. Jazakallah khair, Sister Zahra. This is very nice. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
The 19th, inshallah, right?
Assalamu alaikum. Alaikum assalam wa
rahmatullahi.
Alhamdulillah, how are you doing?
Alhamdulillah, Sheikh. Sheikh, I'm calling from Toronto, Canada.
Okay, and your question is, and your name?
Sheikh, I have a question about the book called Panj Surah. Have you heard about this book, Sheikh? It's pretty famous back home in India and Pakistan.
Called what again?
Panj Surah, five surahs.
Okay. Yasin and... go ahead, describe it for me.
Hello. Okay, this book contains five surahs and it's written by Maulana Muhammad Ilyas Akhtar Qadri Rizvi. And if you read these five surahs, it contains like, you know, surah, let me go with... Surah Muzammil, Surah Mulk, Surah Yasin, Surah Rahman, and Durood.
I got you. What is the question regarding this?
The question is, if we read this, all this, you know, there won't be any evil eye and the jinns won't come in the home and the shayateen won't attack the people.
I got you.
So is it authentically proven or,
I got you. I'll answer you, inshallah. I'll answer you, bi-idhnillah. Jazakallah khair. Barakallah feek. أحسن الله إليك جزاك الله خيرا ما شاء الله very busy tonight. Okay, so sister Umm Ikhlas, I hope this helped, and as I promised you at the very beginning of the show, I will inshallah compile more information on the black seed. But I want to tell you again, the black seed is really more of preventive cure, immunity kind of thing. Brother Mustafa from Denver, Jazahullahu Khaira, I hope to see you on the 19th, inshallah. It is permissible to actually watch or hear the incantation from somebody. You can do that. But I tell you, Brother Mustafa, the best way for the ruqya to work on someone who really needs it is the person himself reciting it. Not even hearing it from a living person. The best way. But it is permissible. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam used to listen to the Quran. And he said, I like to hear it from others. When he called Abu Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, and he said, Iqra alayhi al-Quran ibn Mas'ud. Recite the Quran Abu Mi ibn Mas'ud. And the Rasul heard the Quran from Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, and he said, I like to hear it from others. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, فَإِذَا قُرِئَ الْقُرْآنُ فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ وَأَنصِطُوا لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. If the Quran is recited, whether ruqya shar'iyya or others, hear it and tentatively, so that you may receive the mercy of Allah. But for you to receive the cure, the best one to recite the ruqya is the one who is inflected with an evil eye or sorcery and so forth. Jazakallahu khairan. Our sister Misha from Canada, her question really is, the second one is really tough to handle in a couple of minutes, the style that I follow in order to sign off on time here. But I want to tell you, dear sister Misha, the best da'wah that you can give to your husband is you keeping on performing the salah and keeping on adhering to the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, submitting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wallahi, this is the best da'wah. And one way your husband will see it. Yes, there are people out there who breach two extremes in the religion. Your husband fall a prey, a victim. And this is the problem once you lack the knowledge of Islam. In the area of the Aqidah, which Umm Abdurrahman was hinting to. You see, there are two extremes in Islam. The middle way is the right way. The first extreme, which we do not talk about a lot, called the Irja. What is Irja? Nafyul Amal. They tell you, you normally find the people saying, I have a white heart. I'll be abiyad. This is an Egyptian term. Other people say, Allah is in my heart. Allah is in my heart. Other people say that I have a good intention. Every culture actually developed their own little terminology to reflect irja. Hada irja, this is an extreme. They say that you don't have to pray as long as you have a clean heart. But the heart must lead the body to work. The heart is the engine of the body. If the body parts do not reflect what's in the heart, then what you have really in the heart is not iman at all. Brothers and sisters in Islam, dear sister, just keep inviting your husband to salah with a silent invitation, and that silent invitation that you keep up with the salah, and you never abandon a salah, or you never delay it. That is the best da'wah that you can give to your husband. Inshallah, your salah is valid even though you interact so much with your child while you are praying. But try maybe to put him in a crib during the time when you're praying, in a safe environment during the time when you're praying the five times. Even though if he ends up crying, this is even less destructive than you worrying whether he's going to hit something, fall down, or crash into something. I would try to prepare the environment before I get engaged in the salah. Jazahullah khairan, brother Ishaq, for his invitation to the brothers in Denver to come to the fundraising dinner. Brother who asked, ruling on masturbation is haram, brother. It is haram. That's the ruling, and we can go over this, but it is haram. A Muslim, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam, told us what to do. Man istata'a minkum al-ba'ata falyatazawwaj. If you're able to get married, this is the solution. If you're unable, then you fast. Huh? Cold showers and all that stuff is not going to work, especially. So the solution, the way out is certainly not that. The way out is to fast and to lower your gaze and to stay away from temptation. Our brother Isa, he asked, how did Adam alayhi salam came down to earth? The answer is simple. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded him not to eat from the tree, and Adam did eat from the tree, him and his wife. But you know, when Adam disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he asked Allah to forgive him. And he said, oh Allah, I made a mistake, I'm sorry. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted his repentance, but the expiation for Adam and his offspring is to come down to earth and go through another test. And if we succeed in that test, we'll go back to Jannah, inshallah, brother Isa. And this time, no shaitan will be whispering to us there. Also, there will be no commands. And also, it will be fun to stay out there. Brother Ahmed, stay away from drawing and making pictures of living things. If you like to draw, just draw natural scenes like mountains, trees, water, grass, all of this, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Our brother Mansoor from Washington State, he asked, I advise you, brother Mansoor, I'm telling you, alhamdulillah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is instilling in your heart the light of Iman. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you a much better job than this one. You know, serving unlawful products like pork, and I'm not sure, I forgot to ask you whether the restaurant serves alcohol or not. That's another big issue. But I would rather, brother Mansoor, for you to try to find another job, another career. But please don't break your financial situation here. Don't do this right away. Right now, in your heart, formulate an intention that I want to come out of this environment and I want to work a lawful job. Oh Allah, help me. And keep working, because if you have to provide for yourself, for your family, meanwhile prepare your resume and try to apply for other jobs. This is the best solution. Any other solution would be a halfway. Brother Mansoor, regarding the school of thought of Imam Abi Hanifa, I want to tell you, Abu Hanifa afqahu an-nas. Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah, is the best faqih, يعني, in the face of this earth. But he have mentioned the reason why Abu Hanifa ruled certain, rahimahullah, certain rulings. Not because he had access to the hadith. This is an insult and I would not condone it. No, and I'm sure you did not mean that. He did not have these ahadith, these transmissions, these accounts from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam available at his disposal when he made these rulings. That is why he said, if you come across a hadith that contradicts what I ruled, you follow the hadith. He made it actually more eloquent. إِذَا صَحَّ الْحَدِيثُ فهو مذهبي. If the hadith is authentic, then this is my school of thought. Meaning, the hadith takes over or overrides my ruling. That's what he meant, Abu Hanifa. فإنشاءالله الحمد لله, you already answered yourself, but I would not do it in a fashion that let's just abandon Abu Hanifa. No, there are some things that we do, as even Muslims who are not brought up with the school of thought of Abi Hanifa, that we adopt the view of Imam Abi Hanifa because he had the correct view on the issue. Again, brothers and sisters in Islam, we need to respect and honor these Imams. Their intention was to bring us closer to the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yes, it is true, we should not give them any precedence ahead of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when I find out that there is an authentic hadith that I understood and comprehended well, that contradict the school of thought, then you follow the hadith, and this way you're actually following the advice of these Imams bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Our brother Saad Abbas, I guess Sumayya, already we've given him the nasiha from Maryland, may Allah reward her. Brother Saad Abbas, regarding the moon sighting, please follow your local community who adopt the moon sighting, not the calculation. The calculation has never been established. But now if you end up, Brother Saad, in a situation where this masjid is observing this Eid this day, and this masjid is observing this Eid this day, two different days, just go with those who follow the moon sighting, whether the universal moon sighting or whether the local moon sighting, one of the two, because the calculation which is adopted by major organizations is not condoned by the Quran and Sunnah. But please don't nag about the others. Don't cause this to, don't make this to an issue that disunites you as a community. Let's say that this congregation which follows the moon sighting decided to fast tomorrow, and the people who follow the calculation decided to fast the day after tomorrow. Okay? Don't go out there and nag about those people. You know, just follow the truth, follow the right thing, inshallah, adopt it, and do it in a respectful way. Sister Zahra, may Allah reward her. Inshallah, I look forward to coming to Denver, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Our brother who called from Toronto, be careful with these booklets regarding the virtues of certain verses, certain chapters of the Quran. Bab Fada'il al-Quran is the virtue of certain chapters of the Quran has been a place where a lot of fabricated, weak transmissions, ahadith, been placed in the books of tafsir. I would always verify the evidence the Sheikh has used with regard to the virtue of these five surahs. For sure, we know Tabarak can help us with the fitna in the grave. For sure, we know Al-Baqarah can help us kick shaitan out of the house. So we do have certain chapters of the Quran where we do have authentically transmitted accounts from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which do establish the authenticity, which do establish the virtue of these chapters. So I guess what I'm trying to tell you in simple down to earth language here, verify the evidence that scholar who authored that book used to say that chapter is virtuous. Verify it. With this, we have taken 10 minutes, and I'm sorry, a lot of you were still calling, but I really had to deliver here, and alhamdulillah, we did it, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Dear viewers, brothers and sisters in Islam, I love you all for the sake of Allah, and whatever I said right today is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and whatever I said wrong is from myself and shaitan. And I look forward again to seeing you on Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, inshallah. This is when we have our live show, coming right here from Al-Minhal Academy. And at the end here, I want to say to Brother Islam and Brother Muhammad Salim, Jazakumullahu Khaira, they are looking at me like, when are you going to be done here? Okay, I'm done. It's getting late here tonight in the East Coast, almost 10:41. I love you all for the sake of Allah. And I leave you in the care of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala till the next edition of Let's Talk About It. Take care. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.